briefly go through them. Lunch is provided today, so that's the most important announcement, and it's in the Palm Garden Farm, which I understand is one floor up, so you just take the escalator up to the next floor. Please turn off cell phones and pagers, because it is annoying, particularly to the speakers and other people in the audience. I'd like to say all the chairs will be trapped, and you'll be ejected from your seat if your cell phone goes off, but that's a little bit drastic, so we won't do that. So, message board in the back of the room, so if you have messages for anyone, please feel free to post them or to ask Heather Ganji, who's the coordinator for the course, if you can post a message, something on the board. And then most important, we really plan this course after an analysis of the evaluations that we receive back. So please, after every session, we'd very much appreciate it if you could evaluate all of the speakers and all of the lectures, and it helps us plan for future years and come back, helps us to improve the quality of the course and respond to your needs in terms of what you'd like to see and what you'd like to hear. So the topic this morning is both thoracic and cardiac, and we have a series of lectures that will cover most of the main areas in these two domains. I always like to know a little bit about the audience. How many of you are residents? And I guess I know what you're preparing for, but I won't emphasize that anymore, but probably residents about to take board. How many of you are in practice? Okay, so quite a few. Those in practice, how many of you would categorize yourself in that broad term of general radiologist, realizing you don't do everything, but probably at least a half of you. Okay, all right, that's interesting. Well, that's very helpful information for me. So my talk is going to be on really two major topics. I'm going to talk about interstitial or infiltrative lung disease and peripheral airway. And the purpose of these talks is really to give you a global overview, so I'm going to cover the plain-film findings and high-resolution CT as well. And, you know, the rest of taking boards, you're probably going to see both, so I think it's important that we show both types of images. And what I'm going to emphasize with infiltrative lung disease is an approach. The good news about interstitial or infiltrative lung disease is that there are only about 15 or 20 of these diseases that are common, but there are over 150 causes. So you can't possibly, even with high resolution CT, often make a specific diagnosis. But I've listed here are the ones that you're probably going to encounter in your practice. And they are the interstitial pneumonias, particularly usual interstitial pneumonitis, idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis. I think that's commonly seen in most practices. You'll probably see at least one or two a year. Some of the other interstitial pneumonias, which we'll describe. Pneumoconiosis is very much related to where you live in the geographic area. We still see a lot of asbestos-related disease in Boston. You will on both coasts because of the shipping industry. Asbestos was used in construction throughout the United States, so we still see asbestos-related disease. Silicosis and co-workers, of course, you're going to see in the local areas, either in the West, for example, in Colorado, or in West Virginia. Sarcoidosis, I think, common in everyone's practice. Langerhans cell histiocytosis, or eosinophilic granuloma. Hypersensitivity pneumonitis, I'm convinced that's becoming a more common entity. Now, lymphangioleiomyomatosis is a very popular disease, but relatively rare, so you may or may not see that in your practice. Pulmonary alveolar proteinosis, lymphogenic spreader carcinoma, that is common. The organizing pneumonias, what was previously called WHOOP, is now called chronic organizing or cryptogenic organizing pneumonia, is quite common. Drug-induced disease and chronic eosinophilic pneumonia. So those, I think, are the common 15 to 20 diseases, and those are primarily the ones that I'll discuss this morning. I thought I'd talk about the classic radiograph. You know, I've emphasized how nonspecific the findings are on the plain radiograph, and you know, there's that famous story about Ben Felsen in the old days giving an extensive talk on interstitial lung disease, and that was in the days of just plain radiographs. He came to the end of his talk, and of course, it was the old system where there were carousels and there were slides. And he concluded the talk, and the projectionist raised his hand and said, but Dr. Felsen, you know, there's still one slide left in the carousel. And he had actually been out of synchrony with his diagnoses, you know, for approximately a half an hour. But since everything looked like everything else, I'm glad we don't do as many small bowel follow-throughs, because it's the same sort of problem. But sometimes the radiograph can be Eve, a very classic pathognomonic, a very suggestive, especially with the right history, and the history here is really important. And here is a patient who has really two types of patterns. There are nodules that are about 3 to 5 millimeters in diameter throughout the lungs, but more marked at the bases. And then there are these confluent metastases, one in the right parahyoid area, and others in the left upper lobe with evidence of cavitation and air fluid levels. So this is complicated silicosis, actually silicosis tuberculosis. Fairly straightforward radiograph if you have the right history and you're in the right occupational area. Now this is hard to project on a slide, but this patient had diffuse, very, very, very tiny nodules. But they stand out quite dramatically on the radiograph. And if you had the original radiograph, you had the digital image in front of you in PACS, you'd see that these stand out because they really appear rather dense. They're not obviously calcified, but they're denser than nodules that are that small usually are, and that's why you see them so readily, so easily. And this is an example of a rare disease, but heavily pathognomonic chest x-ray, and this is pulmonary alveolar microlithiasis. And in this hereditary disease, the alveoli are just filled with these calcific concretions. Now, I think the best way to approach both the plain film and infiltrative lung disease or the plain radiograph, since we're all pretty much digital now and not dealing with film, and also HRCT, is to have an approach based on patterns and location and some answer features. So talk about patterns first. And there are really only four that you really have to deal with. That is nodules, small rounded opacities, linear opacities, and sometimes those are combined into what we call reticular nodular pattern. And then what's been called alveolar disease, which is confluent opacities with their bronchograms. You can be certain when you see that that the air spaces are filled with the process, but may have originated in the interstitials. So I think the distinction between interstitial and alveolar isn't all that helpful, but this pattern of consolidation with air bronchograms helps you down the differential pathway. And then finally, ground glass. My personal bias, and I'm not sure everybody would agree with me, is that ground glass is a term that really should be restricted to CT. It's very hard on the standard radiograph to decide if there are ground glass opacities, because an underexposed radiograph, poor inspiration will often appear as increased opacity of ground glass. So it's probably a term best reserved for CT. Now, there are a number of other helpful findings, some that are best appreciated on the standard radiograph rather than CT, that can help in the differential diagnosis of the approach to the disease. One is the lung ones. Are they normal? Are they increased? Are they decreased? Honeycombing, much better seen on CT, but often you can appreciate it on plain films. The presence of adenopathy, and here, again, I think the standard radiograph is important, because if you see bulky adenopathy on the standard radiograph, it helps you in the differential diagnosis. A lot of these diseases are associated with some minimal adenopathy when you do a CT. There's a reactive adenopathy to the disease and more. But if it's apparent on the plain film, it leads you down the differential, such as sarcoidosis. Associated, excuse me, pleural disease, like pleural effusion and thickening, and finally pneumothorax. Okay, let's talk about the nodular pattern first. And I've listed some of the differential diagnoses here, but also the pattern of nodules. And if you read books or articles related to high-resolution CT, you can break the nodular pattern down on HRCT in terms of the anatomic location of the nodules. Are they around the lymphatic, such as sarcoid along the bronchovascular bundles, or subpleural, and I'll show examples of that. Central lobular in the center of the secondary pulmonary lobule, classic examples, hypersensitivity, pneumonitis, random, a hematogenous spreading disease like miliary TB. And then Langerhans cell histiocytosis, silicosis don't quite fit into any of those patterns, although Langerhans cell may be a little bit related to the airways and more central lobular. Ground glass, some of the differential diagnoses on HRCT, pulmonary hemorrhage, pulmonary alveolar prognosis, desmoid interstitial pneumonia, or pneumonitis, which is one of the interstitial pneumonias. These are probably the three most common differentials that you'll encounter. The parenchymal consolidation, we have confluent opacities with their bronchograms. In my experience in dealing with the cases that come through, organizing pneumonia is probably one of the most common chronic eosinophilic pneumonia. So those are the most frequent. Now let's look at some examples. Nodular pattern. We'll start with standard radiographs. I kind of combed this down to the upper two-thirds of the chest. But this is an example of a diffuse nodular pattern, and it helps to decide the size of the nodules. The miliary are going to be 1 to 2 millimeters. These are bigger. They're probably around 3 to 4 millimeters, and they're pretty well-defined without irregular borders. And I cut off the bases here purposely, but the disease was much more in the upper and mid-lung zones. And this is very classic for simple silicosis. You know, you have the right history, you're in the right area of the country, diffuse nodular pattern, these size nodules, and the upper lobe and mid-zone distribution. Now, this is a little bit harder perhaps to appreciate, but this is a diffuse pattern, but the left side's involved much more than the right. When you compare the two, I think you can actually see that there are very tiny 1 to 2 millimeter nodules throughout the lungs. And this is, again, classic miliary tuberculosis. The fact that they're so pinpoint, so tiny, 1 to 2 millimeters, puts you in that particular radiographic differential diagnosis. Now, I want to talk a little bit about sarcoid because it's a granulomatous disease, and the granulomatous diseases will be nodular for the most part, at least early in the phase of disease. And I wanted to take you through the stages of sarcoid. I think you're all familiar with that. Those stages were developed by Sulzbach in the late 50s, early 60s, to indicate prognosis, all based on the standard radiograph. This is obviously pre-CT. But this is a very classic sarcoid. You have what's sometimes called the 1-2-3 sign. There's the right paratracheal and bilateral hilarabdominopathy. If you look carefully, there's often a little convexity there between the aorta and pulmonary artery, and there's actually AP window nodal adenopathy as well, so that's in the prevascular area. So this is a classic sarcoid. It's termed stage one because on the standard radiograph, you don't see any evidence of lung involvement. The lungs here look clear. If you did a CT, you probably would see nodules, and we know 100% of patients with adenopathy alone have sarcoid in the lungs. That's been proven with histology, so in postmortem series, but this is the classic stage one. This is the stage 2, or sometimes called 2A, and this is usually how sarcoid progresses. If you have a longitudinal study of these patients, you'd see that they next develop interstitial lung disease, and it's usually nodular. And note the upper lobe distribution. Now, if you're thinking of granulomatous disease, and this includes infections, which I'm not talking about, but granulomatous infections, such as TB, fungal disease, think of upper lobes. And the same is true with sarcoidosis, non-infectious process, and eosinophilic granuloma, even though it's not called histiocytosis, more upper zone and distribution. And then as the disease progresses, the adenopathy regresses. So there may be some residual adenopathy here. This is in another patient. But notice that the opacity is now mainly in the lung. And there may be a little bit more reticular, not quite so nodular. So this is sometimes called stage 2B. So parenchymal disease without the adenopathy. And this is classic end-stage fibrotic sarcoidosis. About 25% of patients who have parenchymal lung disease when they present will go on to this. So this indicates the worst prognosis. It's called stage 3. And look at the fibrosis. It's very characteristic. It's upper zone. It's often kind of mass-like, like progressive mass of fibrosis and silicosis. There's hyal retraction. It's upper lobe and distribution. It's usually apical and posterior segments, just like TB. So this is very classic fibrotic sarcoidosis. Now, if we look at the HRCT pattern, it's a lymphatic pattern. Remember I mentioned there were three patterns of nodules on high-resolution CT. And now, the lymphatics are distributed centrally along the bronchovascular bundle, so you'll see a lot of central involvement. But there are also a chain of lymphatics in the subpleural area. So subpleural nodules or bunny pleura are common. And then end-stage upper lobe fibrosis, which is often mass-like, and they're associated bullae. Now, I show this because I think this standard radiograph is pretty nondescript. You probably wouldn't call it normal, but there's no adenopathy, and there may be some linear and ill-defined opacities in both lungs. And the high resolution of the CTs is not particularly impressive either. These are really not very fine sections, but if you look carefully, there are some subpleural nodules, and there is a little bit of interstitial thickening along the bronchovascular bundle, and more subpleural nodules in the left lung. And this is sarcoidosis, a pretty mild example where the interstitial lung disease is relatively low grade. Now, this is a more classic presentation here. Notice the lymphatic distribution along the bronchovascular bundle. Sometimes it's called an axial distribution, a central distribution. And then in addition, if you look at the sum nodules, they'll be located right against the pleura. So this is classic lymphatic distribution in sarcoidosis. This is interesting. This is a patient who we might say had airspace sarcoidosis. This is not nodular. It's ground glass, and some areas are even consolidated. And this happens maybe in 5% of parenchymal sarcoidosis, but the distribution is rather characteristic, even though the pattern may be a little bit unusual in terms of the types of opacity. There's certainly adenopathy, but look at these opacities. They're almost hanging off the pleural surfaces. They're along the fissures here. There's an axial distribution coming out from the hilum along the bronchovascular bundles, and this is, again, sarcoidosis. And then the end stage. And notice that there are almost mass-like and nodular and some ground glass opacities in the upper lobes. And then the distribution is not only upper lobe, but it reflects the lymphatics again. It's central, it's axial. And it almost looks a little bit like radiation, doesn't it? Radiation fibrosis. They're mass-like areas of fibrosis, and note the dilated bronchi, which are what do we call that? Traction bronchiectasis, exactly. It's secondary to the fibrosis, is the guy wire effect that's dilating the bronchi. So the central distribution of fibrosis up a lobe, very characteristic of sarcoidosis. And this one is really interesting because it's, again, a mass-like area of fibrosis. Notice it's in the posterior segments of the upper lobe, remember apical and posterior segments, just like TB, is the granulomatous disease, and some central bronchial dilatation as well. Looks very similar to the progressive massive fibrosis you see in silicosis. Okay, let's move on to lymphangitic spread of tumor. This is both linear and nodular opacities, but I've included in the nodule. And often in the correct clinical context, we can make a very specific diagnosis, I think, on the basis of the high-resolution CT. Because the prominent features are septal thickening and is usually beaded or nodular. The presence of polygonal structures, which will stand out very in a very obvious way when you look at the HRCT slices. And these polygonal structures are the secondary lobules. And there's often, more centrally, nodular thickening of the bronchovascular bundles. And here is an example. It's actually a lung cancer that has spread unilaterally by lymphogenic spread in the lung. And first of all, note all these polygonal structures. These are the secondary lobules, and the center is the pulmonary artery. It's very prominent because in the interstitium around the artery, there's probably a tumor as well. The artery and the bronchus are right in the center. And these are all thickened septal lines, and some of them I think you can appreciate, as well as in the fissure, that they're nodular. So this is the polygons. The nodular septal thickening, very indicative of lymphogenic spread of carcinoma. And here is another example again. And notice as well, as you get more centrally, there's the nodular thickening along the bronchovascular bundles. And look at these polygons lined up in the subpleural areas with beading and nodular thickening of the interlobular septum. Now let's move on to the linear pattern. And again, I'm showing you the common diseases, but the best example of a linear pattern is going to be one of the chronic interstitial pneumonias, and that's UIP. Now, if UIP has no cause, it's called idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis. So idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis is a clinical term, and UIP is what the pathologist uses. And classically, the findings, I think, are familiar to you all. It's a coarse reticular pattern, much more marked at the base. This is peripheral and subpleural in location, unlike sarcoid I showed you, which was central. There's septal thickening, honeycombing, which really helps make the diagnosis. This means an end-stage fibrotic lung and traction bronchiectasis. And just to show a standard radiograph, this is obviously a very advanced case. Notice the distribution on the standard radiograph is in the mid and lower lung zones, particularly in the bases. The peripheral distribution is often hard to recognize in the plain radiograph. You really need CT to do that. I mentioned that idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis is a term used when no cause is determined. Is there somebody who's really awake here in the audience? Probably going to be one of my residents who's seen this case before. That's it. But anybody see a cause? This is an example of pulmonary fibrosis. There's coarse reticular opacities there. You can see on this radiograph that they're peripheral. There might even be some honeycomb. Anybody? Esophagus, right, okay. So there's a dilated esophagus. So this patient has systemic sclerosis of scleroderma with a dilated aperiostaltic esophagus. Now, patients with collagen vascular disease can have either UIP, a they can have another entity that was described in the late 1980s, which is non-specific interstitial pneumonitis, which also is a fibrotic disease, but it progresses much more slowly and doesn't have quite as bad a prognosis. This was actually UIP. Now, here are the high-resolution CT findings. This patient has somewhat asymmetrical disease, but it shows a number of features. Notice on the left that the involvement definitely is subpleural and peripheral in location. It's honeycombing, which are these rounded lucencies, and they usually have a moderately thick wall, so they're not like cysts because their wall's thick. They're usually less than diameter, not always. And they're stacked up like coins in the subpleural area, so this is honeycombing. And they're not really a great example of traction bronchiectasis, but there's probably one bronchus here that's a little dilated and looks a bit varicose. Notice that there's some ground glass opacity, and ground glass doesn't tell you much. Ground glass may be produced by very fine fibrosis, and that's what we have here. So we've got fibrosis a little bit more advanced on the right side than the left side. I have no explanation in this patient for why that's the case. But this is classic UIP or idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis. Another example here, this is in the upper zone. Note again the subpleural fibrosis, the honeycombing, architectural distortion. Look at the way this pulmonary artery is branching. It's not a nice division of the pulmonary artery at sort of acute angles. It's taking these bends, and it looks like it's somehow there's some traction on it, and there are these long linear bands. So architectural distortion is another feature of this disease. Okay, I want to talk a little bit about the cystic pattern. For practical purposes, I think when you're dealing with cysts, you really appreciate those only while on HRCT. Sometimes you'll have a case of, say, histiocytosis, and you can actually see the cysts in the plain film. But this is really an analysis that depends on high-resolution CT. And I want to talk about a couple of diseases that are characterized by cysts. And I want to make a distinction. I talked about honeycombing, and you'll read in some of the textbooks honeycomb cysts. Well, they are kind of cystic looking structures, but they have much thicker walls. So what I'm talking about here are very thin wall structures. They're lucencies that have a wall that's probably 1 to 2 millimeters at most. So lymphangeal leiomyomatosis is a very interesting disease that occurs in young women of reproductive age. They have abnormal smooth muscle proliferation within the lung, and this leads to airway obstruction, so they get air trapping, they develop complicating pneumothoraces. They can also have chylospleural effusions because the lymphatics are obstructed as well. So what you see in these patients are thin wall cysts that vary in size with a random distribution, and the lungs are otherwise normal. So you're not going to see signs of fibrosis that I talked about in both sarcoid or UIP. It's going to be otherwise normal lungs. Now, this is a radiograph on a patient with lamina. And I think if you look at that left lung, it looks pretty normal. But you can see there's a pneumothorax here on the right, and she is presented with 2 or 3 episodes of spontaneous pneumothorax. So she went to surgery for pleurodesis, and the surgeon thought the underlying lung was very abnormal, so he took a biopsy of the lung. And here on the high-resolution CT, you can see these multiple thin wall cysts that randomly distributed throughout the lung. They were both upper and lower and mid-lung zones. There's no traction bronchiectasis here. There are no nodules, really no lines. This is a postoperative finding here. And here is the other lung, and you can see they vary a bit in size, but most of them are a centimeter or less, so maybe just a little bit more. So randomly distributed throughout the lungs. And this is an example of what a lung specimen looks like in a patient with lymphangeal leiomyomatosis. Now, the other important disease that's characterized by cysts is Langerhans cell histiocytosis, previously referred to as eosinophilic granuloma. Now, the distinction with this disease from LAM is that it's characterized by nodules as well as cysts. And they can measure anywhere from 2 millimeters to 2 centimeters, and you may have nodules alone without the cysts. There probably is an evolution of the disease where initially it's a granulomatous process with nodules. These nodules cavitate or shell out and then form thin wall cysts. So you may see all these findings together, or you may see one out of the three. The distribution is more in the upper lobes, and I think you probably all remember the classic teaching that on the standard radiograph, the costophrenic angles are spare. So here's a patient that has, I think, a nice example of Langerhans cell histiocytosis in different stages. There are some solid nodules. There are nodules that are cavitating or shelling out, and these are located near the airways, small airways, but we often have some evidence of some mild peripheral airway obstruction. And there might be one here that is almost at the cystic stage. Same patient again. Most of the involvement is upper and mid-zone distribution, and you see some thin wall cysts right near the end of an airway there, as well as nodules, and as well as shelled out or cavitated nodules. And here is an example, again, of histiocytosis. This is almost purely cystic. Very difficult to distinguish it, I think, from LAM. You'd obviously want the history. These patients are usually smokers, so that's a very important part of the history, is the fact that they are chronic smokers, and they usually get better when they stop smoking. But there are one or two nodules as well, and then a thicker wall cyst, which is probably the nodule that's shelled out. And then I have David Lynch from Colorado to thank for this. This is pure cystic on the entire CT scan. You couldn't see a single nodule. So again, if this is a woman, you might have a lot of difficulty differentiating this from lymphangioline mitosis. There were just multiple thin wall cysts throughout the line. So this is probably the later phase of the disease. Now let's look at some HRCT ground glass opacification. And I've listed about four of the common diagnoses. This is not meant to be totally inclusive, but I think you need to get a sense of the statistical occurrence or prevalence of these diseases. And I've listed hypersensitivity pneumonitis, desmotive interstitial pneumonitis, alveolar proteinosis, and pulmonary hemorrhage. Now, somebody once commented, why did you show a film from 1965? But this actually was a film that belonged to Avril Lebo. Now, I don't know, is there anybody in the audience? I'm probably, Avril Lebo was, but he was the original pathologist that described all the interstitial pneumonitis, usual interstitial pneumonitis, desmotive, and so forth. So this is from Dr. Danslow, who gave me this. And this was a patient that's already been a thoracotomy, so he's post-biopsy. But this is an example of desmotive interstitial pneumonitis. And I think it shows kind of patchy alveolar consolidation and ground glass opacities in the mid and lower lung zones that we're familiar with. But this is much easier and should be diagnosed in high-resolution CT. The current thinking in this disease is that it's a separate entity from UIP. It's seen in smokers, so it's probably a smoking-related disease. And I don't have time to go into all of the interstitial pneumonitides, but there is a disease called respiratory bronchiolitis, interstitial lung disease, and this may be a variant of that. So it's smoking-related. These patients get better with steroids. They usually don't develop fibrosis, so it has a good prognosis. And the hallmark here is ground glass opacification. It's usually worse again in the mid and the lower lung zones. No limits, a lack of architectural distortion, no honeycombing, no traction bronchiectasis. And again, it's patchy. This one happens to be pretty peripheral. They're not always subpleural like this, but occasionally it can be. So again, just classic ground glass opacity. This is DIP or desmotive interstitial pneumonitis. Alveolar proteinosis, fairly uncommon disease. It's probably related to some abnormality in either the production or the clearance of surfactant, the alveoli filled with this proteinaceous material. It classically has a central distribution. It will have ground glass opacities or consolidation or a combination of both. And then there's a very characteristic pattern described in high resolution CT, and it's not exclusive to this disease, but is fairly classic for it. That's the crazy paving pattern. And here is a patient with pulmonary alveolar proteinosis. Notice it's more central than peripheral. There is mostly ground glass opacification, maybe a little consolidation here. And then it looks like we're seeing interlobular septum here. And there's some debate about whether those borders are actually interlobular septum. But this is what's called the crazy paving pattern. So when you see that kind of those borders there, those polygonal structures in the midst of ground glass, that's commonly seen in pulmonary alveolar proteinosis. And then just an example lower down, this is almost becoming consolidation here. This is ground glass, but you can definitely see this crazy paving pattern. Now, I think this projects actually moderately well. This is always hard sometimes to show, but this is an example of ground glass opacification, but it looks very different from the DIP that I showed you, and it's very different from the pulmonary arterial prognosis. And here the ground glass opacification is nodular. And these are central lobular nodules that we're looking at, surrounded by areas of normal lung. So this, one could put this within the nodular pattern if you want to, but the importance is these aren't solid nodules, they're ground glass nodules, they're a little bit difficult to see. And this is very characteristic of hypersensitivity pneumonitis. You may have these nodules only, or you may have more confluent areas of ground glass. Typically more upper mid zone distribution, not the lower lobe. So, and anybody else, anything else in your differential for this? Upper lobe ground glass nodules? Yeah, is this respiratory bronchiolitis that I talked about, which is a smoker's disease, also has the same sort of pattern. And this is lower down, still present lower down, it's more marked than the other zones. Now let's talk about airspace disease in terms of consolidation. And again, I wanted to touch on the common diagnoses here. There's bronchiolitis obliterans, organizing pneumonia. The British first described this as cryptogenic organizing pneumonia. It's probably a better term because the bronchiolitis plays a very minor part in this disease. It's mostly the organizing pneumonia. Chronic eosinophilic pneumonia, pulmonary alveolar proteinosis, as I said, can produce ground glass, but may produce consolidation as well. And then one always has to include in the differential some diffuse tumors. I know the topic is infiltrative lung disease, but bronchioalveolar carcinoma lymphoma can create consolidation as well. A couple of examples. This is pulmonary alveolar proteinosis, really consolidated here. But notice again the tendency for central distribution, perihilar. And this is a patient with peripheral airspace consolidation, exquisitely peripheral, subpleural in location, and this is one of the eosinophilic syndromes. So whenever you have an eosinophilic process, it's classically peripheral in distribution. The term was used, photographic negative pulmonary edema on the standard radiogram. And the same patient, just a thinner section here showing the peripheral. And this is definitely consolidated. It's not ground glass. Now I'm going to spend just a few minutes going through some ancillary findings that may be helpful for you, either on HRCT or standard radiogram, in terms of coning in the differential diagnosis. The presence of adenopathy, and as I mentioned, what's important is adenopathy that can be seen on the standard radiogram is large enough that you can appreciate it. The size of the lungs, are they small, normal, or large? The presence of pleural disease, either pneumothorax, effusion, and thickening, and I'm including pleural plaques with that. Honeycombing, and then the location and distribution of disease. Small lungs, the fibrotic diseases. So UIP, collagen vascular diseases, and asbestosis, which is a parenchymal fibrosis due to asbestos exposure. And again, I'm trying to show some old classic cases here, but this is a patient with UIP, and over a 5-year interval, you can see the not only linear passages of bases, but more shrinkage in lung volume. And this is interesting because this patient had a pretty normal chest x-ray, but initially presented with a little shortness of size, pulmonary function tests were just minimally abnormal. They progressed. The chest x-ray still looks normal. Probably would see something if you did a high resolution CT if they were available way back when. But notice the marked decrease in lung volume. And this patient had desquamative interstitial pneumonitis. So the only sign on the radiograph was a small lung volume. Normal or large lungs. Large lungs, particularly in lymphangiomyomyelomatosis, because these abnormal lymphatics obstruct the small airways and they get air trapped. Sarcoid usually is pretty normal sized lungs of Langerhans cytosis. So even though the interstitial disease may be very severe, the lung volumes are maintained. And a couple of classic cases, again, this is a young woman who had LAM. She presented with the pneumothorax originally, and this is nice because there's a 10-year follow-up on plain films. She had surgery on the side for pleurisy, but she now has developed severe respiratory symptoms. She has pulmonary arterial hypertension, and if you look at the size of that left lung as compared with the previous, it's definitely much more overinflated. And this is an example of large lungs that you can see in lymphangiomyomatosis. Adenopathy, again, referring more to the plain film than the HRCT. Common in sarcoidosis, may or may not be present in lymphatic proteinuria and silicosis and hypersensitivity to pneumonitis. That means fibrosis, destruction of the lung with these randomly distributed ASKs that align by fibrosis. So again, common to idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, so UIP, asbestosis. Sarcoidosis is rare. Remember I told you the fibrosis and sarcoid was upper lobe and mass-like, but occasionally you can see honeycomb. And sometimes you can appreciate it on plain films. Maybe a little bit of a struggle here, but there may be a suggestion of some rounded lucencies at the bases in the midst of the diffuse reticular pattern. Perhaps here as well, there are more cysts, actually, at least cysts. I mean, you're not sure what the honeycomb cysts are until you actually see the thickness of the wall in the high-resolution CT, but I think you can see that in plain film. Pleural effusion, how do they help? Well, pleural effusion may be seen with collagen vascular disease, such as rheumatoid disease, for example. They may have both some interstitial fibrosis and nonspecific interstitial pneumonitis plus pleural effusion. Lymphangitic carcinomatosis, very common to have pleural effusions. And as I mentioned, on pharyngeomyomatosis, a LAM, they may have chylus effusion. Pleural thickening can be seen, of course, with asbestosis. And also the collagen vascular diseases, rheumatoid again being the example. Rheumatoid effusions are usually chronic, they go on for a long time. When they eventually are either treated or they resolve, they usually leave some residual pleural thickening. And this is a patient with asbestosis, very severe involvement in the bases, very coarse reticular pattern. And I'm not going to spend too much time on this because Dr. Shepard is going to talk much more extensively on pleural disease and show you much more pleural plaquing and pleural thickening, but there is definitely pleural thickening here as well. Now, pneumothorax can occur as a complication of any end-stage interstitial lung disease, but it's most common in these two entities. It's assumed that, not assumed, but there have been studies to show that 6% of patients with LAM develop a complicated pneumothorax. And LAM's leiomyosarcoidosis, the incidence of the prevalence is less, but it is a common complication. And this is a patient with his okay, you can probably see some of the cysts in the underlying lung and a complicated pneumothorax. Distribution, upper lobe diseases, we talked about this before, the granulomatous diseases, sarcoidosis, Langerhans cell histiocytosis, silicosis, coliosis, and I put in one that you may see one in your practice during your entire life, but it's always kind of a nice example, is ankylosing spondylitis. This is a patient with ankylosing spondylitis with marked fibrosis in the upper lobes and hyoid retraction. And you can see a calcification in the anterior longitudinal nerve. Lowosomes, think of fibrosis, UIP, collagen vascular disease, asbestosis. And again, a patient with UIP. Okay. Diffuse diseases, central versus peripheral, central pulmonary arterial prognosis, peripheral, chronic eosinophilic pneumonia, and cough or hope. And this is one of the best plain films I have showing peripheral distribution in a chronic eosinophilic pneumonia, really in the axillary zone of the lung. It tends to be a little bit more upper than lower zone. This one has some lower zone involvement. This is sometimes called a photographic negative of pulmonary edema because of the peripheral distribution. This is the pulmonary alveolar prognosis, much more central than peripheral. And we also have to remember the differential diagnosis for bleeding processes. Areas of infiltrative lung disease that jump from one part of the lung to the other without any treatment. And this is an example of an asthmatic, actually, with some consolidation in the lower lung zone. And then 2 weeks later, that's cleared, and abnormalities and calcifications have developed in the opposite lung, in the left upper lung zone. And this was an eosinophilic syndrome. Not quite a chronic eosinophilic pneumonia, probably more likely something like a leftless syndrome in this patient with opacities that moved around. So that's in the differential as well when you think about location. Now, we've talked about all these interstitial pneumonias, and I stole this from Nestor, but it's always nice to start end the talk by saying may they all rest in peace, all from the UIP, the DIP, and everything else. Okay, let's move on to the second part of the talk, and I'm going to talk about the airways. I'm going to confine mainly to the center bronchi and the peripheral airways in the lung. I really won't deal with the trachea and the major bronchi. A lot of that's going to be covered, for example, in lung cancer, they talk about the bronchi. So I'm going to talk about more peripheral airway disease. And And the talk is divided really into two major topics, and that's bronchiectasis, the findings of bronchiectasis and the differential diagnosis. And I'm going to spend some time as well on small airways disease, orthobronchiolitis and restrictive bronchiolitis. And this can sometimes get confused, surprisingly, I think, on stem radiographs and even initially on CT with some of the interstitial or infiltrative processes that we've talked about. So let's talk about bronchiectasis. Now, the etiology of bronchiectasis in most cases is due to infection, and it can be very localized due to bronchial obstruction in a single lobe. But more often, it's multiple lobes or it's diffuse. And I've listed some of the common diseases, some of which are confined to the lung, some of which are more systemic. Allergic bronchopulmonary aspergillosis occurs in asthmatics, produces a central bronchiectasis, cystic fibrosis, of course, and motile cilia syndrome, all associated with diffuse bronchiectasis, and immunodeficiency states that are characterized by multiple pulmonary infections. Now, the rest of these are pretty rare, and I'm sure those studying for boards know about these as causes of bronchiectasis, but it's really what I showed on the first slide is what you're likely to encounter in your clinical practice. Now, multi-detector CT has really changed our analysis. I think everyone agreed that you needed thin sections to diagnose bronchiectasis, and we used to do the standard high-resolution CT with the bone algorithm with 1 to 1.5 millimeter collimation. I think now, let me ask you, how many of you have multi-detector CTs in your practice? Okay, most people, all right. So most of you can easily go back and reconstruct thin slices, but probably a 2.5 is probably sufficient for diagnosing bronchiectasis. It may be difficult to diagnose bronchiectasis if you have field with thick slices, 7 or 10 millimeter thick slices. But it's important to do some expiration CTs, and we tend to do 6 selected slices that are distributed evenly from the apex to the base of the lung. And this is to demonstrate air traffic. And we do that as part of our quote interstitial or airway protocol because sometimes we look at the findings and we think maybe there's a small airways problem, not an interstitial lung disease. And expiration views can be really helpful to show air traffic. So whenever you're thinking about airway disease in the lungs, whether it be bronchiectasis or small airway disease, it's important to get expiration views. Now, the features of bronchiectasis have been well described. By definition, bronchiectasis means dilation of the bronchi, with usually some inflammation, even destruction in the wall. Characterized by thickening of the wall, visibility of bronchi in the periphery of the lung, even on high-resolution CT in the very peripheral subfloral area, you really can't see the bronchi in the small airways. And then contour abnormalities, actual change in the contour of the bronchi. Now, years ago, this classification was developed of bronchiectasis. It deals with severity, the cylindrical being the mildest form, and the bronchi just dilated, but they don't really lose their shape. And I've listed some of the findings. Most of these are what you can appreciate, of course, on CT. A lot of this you're not going to see on the plain film at all. You see, and I'll show examples of that. The signet ring sign, tram tracking, and the lack of tapering of the bronchi. Varicose is the next most severe category, and it's just like varicose veins. They look like a string of pearls. There's not only dilatation, but there's constriction areas, or maybe some constriction followed by areas of dilatation. And then finally, the most severe form, you'll see this in patients, for example, cystic fibrosis, where the bronchi are actually ballooned out and form cystic areas or sacs, and they clusters of strings of cysts, and they may contain the fluid levels of this active infection. Some of the other features, it's not unusual in bronchiectasis for any cause to find fluid or mucus within the bronchi, so you may have evidence of mucoid impaction. And atelectasis, if you have a single area of the lung, a single lobe involved with bronchiectasis, eventually the lobe will lose volume, become somewhat fibrotic, and normally there can be between the hilum and the periphery of the lung, the pleural surface, up to 25 divisions of the bronchus. Severe bronchiectasis, there may be only 5 divisions before you reach the pleural surface, so there's definitely loss of lung parenchyma. So atelectasis can be a feature. Now let's look at some examples. Here's a patient with fairly severe bronchiectasis. And you can see cystic acetabula. Notice that the bronchus is dilated, the wall is thickened. Excuse me. The bronchi can either be air-filled, but often they're filled with mucus. You can see dilated bronchi here. They're branching. They're filled with mucus. And notice the lack of tapering. You're seeing bronchi almost all the way out to the pleural surface. Thickened bronchial wall, you can see in cross-section as well. This patient is something we'll talk about a little bit later, what's called a mosaic pattern. There's an area of white here, maybe it's easier to describe rather than call it ground glass, where increased opacity or increased attenuation, but white areas alternating with black areas. And the white area is the normal lung here. Notice there's not too much bronchiectasis in that area. The black areas are areas of air trapping that are abnormal because of the bronchiectasis. And the same patient again. Notice these bronchi are branching, they're just filled with mucus, sticking bronchial wall. Now, here's an example of varicose bronchiectasis, so that's the second category, second most severe category. Notice the lack of tapering of the bronchus. In fact, it's getting bigger as we head on to the pleural surface. This is a beautiful signet ring sign. Remember that the bronchus lies right next to the pulmonary artery, right out to the periphery, to the pleural surface. And they should have roughly a 1-to-1 ratio in diameter, a little bit of variation. This is the pulmonary artery. This is a coming bronchus, and it must be about 3 times in diameter, greater than the coming pulmonary artery. So this is often called the signet ring sign. It's a good indication of bronchial dilation, and notice the wall is thickened as well. This is a patient with allergic bronchopulmonary aspergillosis. This occurs in asthmatics. They often get mucus plugging. Aspergillus grows in the plugs. They get a hypersensitivity reaction. So it's not really invasive aspergillus in the sense of the disease that occurs in immunocompromised patients, local immunologic reaction to the aspergillus in the airways. Now, this patient has expectorated most of the mucus plugs, but you can see what's left behind is this varicose bronchiectasis, and notice that it's pretty central. We're not seeing those dilated bronchi out of the periphery that I showed you in the other cases. And this is one of the hallmarks of this disease, is central bronchiectasis. And this is a patient with cystic fibrosis. Very severe bronchiectasis. The bronchi now created these huge cysts or saccules here. They're just, diameters are just blown out. There are multiple other bronchi with thickened walls and with dilation. This patient has a complicated pneumothorax. Notice again that mosaic pattern, you know, the areas of black and white lung alternating. This is another patient with cystic fibrosis, and just to show you what some clinicians sometimes call wet bronchiectasis. You can actually see some air fluid levels in the bronchi here. Just, every bronchus has just been kind of replaced with the cystic dilatation. And although most of the bronchiectatic segments are air-containing, some are fluid and some are just filled with mucus. Atelectasis. Now, this is a complex case because this patient's emphysema has a big bulla here. But you can see that the left lower lobe has lost a tremendous amount of volume, and within it are dilated bronchi. And this was a chronic finding. This lobe was partially collapsed in ears or bulli within it, but there's also evidence of bronchiectasis. And this is just an example of a patient with chronic bronchiectasis, probably had a very severe pneumonia in his youth, and maybe even before the antibiotic era, and developed a chronically bronchiectatic lobe, and it's relatively airless and has lost a tremendous amount of volume. So atelectasis can occur just due to the bronchiectasis alone without a central endobronchial obstruction. So you don't have to have an obstructed cancer to produce this. Here, this is a post-pertussis patient who has cystic bronchiectasis. You can see it's involving all lobes, particularly the middle lobe and the lingula, and the middle lobe, portions of the middle lobe, which is about completely collapsed and airless. So again, the atelectasis due to the bronchiectasis. And then loss of volume with some bronchiectasis in a patient with tuberculosis. When you see upper lobe bronchiectasis, one of the differentials, of course, is tuberculosis. And in the chronic heal phase, there may still be bronchiectasis present. These patients may have been treated. They present years later with pneumoctasis from the bronchiectasis. So a lot of associated loss of volume. Now, HRCT is certainly the way thin section CT to diagnose bronchiectasis is a pretty granular classic study, I think, in the late 1980s, where he compared thick section CT with high resolution CT, and there was no question that high resolution CT improved both the sensitivity and the specificity of diagnosis of bronchiectasis. Now, there are some pitfalls, and I'd just like to briefly show you some examples and mention them. Sometimes respiratory or cardiac motion can produce almost a double exposure, so you see the vessels twice, and it looks like these vessels are forming the walls of a dilated bronchus. I think you see it mostly in the lingula or the anterior basal segment of the left lower lobe right next to the heart. Reversible bronchiectasis, when you have an acute pneumonia, the bronchi will dilate. They usually not deform, but there will be cylindrical bronchiectasis, and it may take 2 or 3 months for that to go back to normal. So, you know, when you diagnose a patient on CT and you say, oh, there's pneumonia, there's underlying bronchiectasis, well, remember that bronchiectasis is reversible, and it doesn't mean that the pneumonia has been superimposed on an area of previous infection of bronchiectasis. I showed you nice examples, I mentioned at least traction bronchiectasis. And then what I call pseudobronchiectasis is sometimes confusion of parenchymal cysts with bronchiectasis. Now, you think that differentiation would be easy, but sometimes it can be difficult in given instances. And again, I don't know whether you can quite appreciate it here, but there looks like a thickened, slightly dilated bronchi here, and this is just due to cardiac motion creating this sort of almost double exposure effect and what looked like transtracting and dilated bronchi. Now, this is a patient with idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, a UIP, and some examples of traction bronchiectasis here. This looks very varicoid. And of course, this is a secondary phenomenon, not a primary phenomenon. It occurs secondary to the guide wire effect of pulling apart the bronchi due to the fibrosis of the parenchyma of the lung. And I show this case, I know Dr. Shepard, this was something we all pondered here, we had a lot of difficulty with. This was in his 40s, he was a Vietnamese immigrant, he didn't speak any English, and he came in with a history of cough for a long time and fever, and he had all the cystic structures throughout the lung, and notice they're more central than they are peripheral. And we struggled a lot trying to decide whether these were parenchymal cysts or would they possibly be cystic bronchiectasis. But if you look carefully, the central airways here are pretty normal without dilatation. And it's hard really to find any example of, say, a signet ring sign where you can link up one of these cysts or accompanying pulmonary vessel. And the periphery of the lung is spared. You know, we don't see any dilated bronchi. Most of the cases I've showed you, diffuse bronchiectasis is some mucus plugging or some bronchial abnormality out in the periphery. So this is an example, maybe what you call pseudocyst. This patient turned out to have be HIV positive, and this was pneumocystis-carinii pneumonia, and you probably know that cysts are a complication of that. He had neglected treatment, he had, you know, he didn't have insurance, he was an immigrant and so forth, and it was only really when he had very severe symptoms that he came in, and this is an example of diffuse parenchymal cysts and not bronchiectasis. Now, sometimes inspiration expiration will help this patient with cystic fibrosis with bronchiectasis, but on the inspiration view, you can see on the inspiration CT, a thickened dilated bronchus here. Now, normally, even bronchiectatic segments usually will collapse to some degree on expiration, and you can see the change in the shape of this bronchus on the expiratory view. You can see the areas of antrapping here. And this is can be useful in distinguishing cysts from bronchi. Usually cysts are kind of slow spaces, so you will get in, but on expiration they're going to collapse very, very slowly on that bronchi. Mucus plugging. Pretty easy to recognize a feature of a lot of bronchiectasis here, and you can see that many of the peripheral bronchi here are filled with mucus and secretions. This is classic mucoid impaction in an asthmatic. It's almost a mucus seal. The bronchus is tremendously dilated and filled with mucus, and you can recognize it because of this glove finger sign, these branching opacities here that are emanating from the heart and extending out towards the periphery of the lung. Now, when you look in cross-section, some of these mucoid impactions may look like nodules. And now I think with multi-detector CT, it's easy with 2D reformatting. And to follow these, if you just have axial CT up and down, relate them to the airway, and not consider them the evidence of a pulmonary nodule in the parenchyma. Another nice example of mucoid impaction. And just a couple of examples of rather unusual entities here. Okay, we'll see if the residents are awake. What's this disease? Okay, Munir Kuhn. Okay, this is tracheobronchial megaly, very rare disease that is characterized by abnormal dilation of the trachea and also the major bronchi. And these are like these little pseudodiverticula that come into the lumen. They have a great deal of difficulty clearing secretions, and they usually have severe infection of bronchiectasis in the lung. Notice how dilated the left main bronchus is, and notice the cystic and as well as cylindrical bronchiectasis is present within the lung, a little bit more distally, extending out almost to the pleural surface. And this again is allergic bronchopulmonary aspergillosis, central bronchiectasis here, the periphery of the lung isn't involved. This isn't an asthmatic, and typically more upper lobe distribution. I want to mention Mycobacterium complex. We only see 2 to 3 cases of this a week on CT. It's for women over the age of 50 here, we all have to worry about this disease. MAI infection is seen in multiple contexts. It can be cause infection in immunocompromised patients like AIDS. There's a classical form, it's just like TB, but it's much more chronic, upper lobe cavitary disease. But what I'm going to talk about is this MAI infection that occurs in middle age and elderly women. They're otherwise healthy. They have no history of previous pulmonary disease. The classical form tends to occur in people who are somewhat debilitated and have underlying emphysema. And what it is characterized by are the following features. It's an older woman, and actually I think we're seeing more in the 50 and over age group as well, so it's not really elderly women. They're non-smokers. Slow progression of disease, involves multiple lobes, bilateral, characterized by bronchiectasis and small nodules, which are granulomas. Tree and bud opacities, which are secretions within the small airway. And the lobes most affected are the middle lobe and lingual, even though all lobes may be affected. And this is not colonization, this is actually active, a slow indolent infection. And this is a thick section CT, and I show you the thick section to show the multiple nodules that are present, but there are some branching opacities in the periphery. And on the thin section CT, you can see evidence of bronchiectasis involving the middle lobe and lingual, and also to a lesser extent, the lower lobe. And peripherally, there are evidence of these branching peripheral opacities, which are secretions in the small airways, the so-called tree and bud sign. I'll show you more examples of that later. So this is MAI infection, difficult to treat, requires poor drugs. Usually pulmonologists will not treat this unless there's evidence of progression, but it seems to be a very common disease. And by the way, MAI is in the Boston water, so for those of you who are visiting, when you take a shower, don't inhale. Okay. And more tree and butter calcium. Okay, now we'll finish off with the small airways. And these are defined, when I talk about small airways, as bronchioles, which are, by definition, equal to or less than 2 millimeters in diameter and have no cartilage in their walls. On HRCT, they're not seen normally. You can probably see with very thin sections right to about the origin of the bronchioles, right to about 2 millimeters. They're in the center of the secondary pulmonary lobule, and this is a high-resolution CT of a slice that's actually been taken after a lobectomy. So we have a relatively thin slice of lung here with a thin section, 1.5 millimeter section and a bone algorithm. And this is a normal lung. And you can see this is about a scar peripheral lesion. Yeah, that's probably about a 2 or 3 millimeter airway. So we're getting right to the small airways here with the absolute best resolution we can get. And notice we're not seeing the bronchi in the periphery. You can sort of see here almost a secondary pulmonary lobule with the pulmonary artery in the center, but you don't see the bronchus. Now this is a patient who had edema in the lung, and you can see they got interlobular septa, and of course there's going to be peribronchial edema as well. So in this case, you begin to see more of the small peripheral airways because there's some edema or interstitial lung disease surrounding them. So normally they're not that. Technique. Again, with multi detector CT, I think it's pretty easy to get thin sections, but it's really the same technique as they use for bronchiectasis. And remember, inspiration, expiration views are very helpful. Now, there are two main types of bronchiolitis. There's a proliferative or inflammatory, and then the constrictive bronchiolitis obliterans. They have different etiologies, and they look very different radiographically, and particularly on high resolution CT. The proliferative is an acute site of the bronchiolitis with an inflammatory agent. The constrictive is, just as it indicates, the bronchiolitis obliterans, where the peripheral bronchi are actually obstructed. It tends to be a very patchy process in the lung. It doesn't involve all the small airways, but there'll actually be constriction and fibrosis of the distal ends of the small airways. And proliferative bronchiolitis, because it's inflammatory, it's usually the atypical organisms, like it's usually associated with viral infection, mycoplasma, respiratory bronchiolitis, we've already touched on, we discussed interstitial lung disease. I'm just going to show an example of an uncommon disease, but just to show you the features, which is Asian panbronchiolitis. So on HRCT, what you're going to see are enlargement of core structures in the secondary lobule, tree and bud opacities, and air trapping. And this is actually a bacterial infection of bronchiolitis. I think this is in a post-transplant patient, usually viral. But you see these peripheral opacities that branch. There may be nodules as well as branching structures. And the nodules are a little bit deep to the pleura. They're not right up against the pleural surface. And they're usually about a centimeter or so apart. So these are central lobular, either branching structures or nodules that represent the small airways that are filled with secretions. We're running a little bit late here, so I won't spend a lot of time talking about the diverticulitis, but just, and this is from Japan, and you can see on the plain film, she's got some opacities at the base, but very overinflated. And this is what her HRCT looks like. She has some central airway disease. She has some bronchiectasis, and that will happen as well when you have a bronchiolitis, but it's not saccular bronchiectasis, it's usually cylindrical. But most of the findings are out in the peripheral airways, and again, you have these wishbone peripheral branching opacities, 2 or 3 millimeters deep to the floor, kind of lined up about half a centimeter apart. These are central lobular branching opacities, which are bronchi that are filled with mucus and secretions, and this is a proliferative bronchiolitis. Another example of that tree and bud opacification, I guess this is a twig here, and then you see the little branches coming off. This is an airway, again, filled with mucus and secretions and branching peripheral. Respiratory bronchiolitis we talked about before, seen in smokers, it may present just with ground glass, but more frequently it's like the hypersensitivity pneumonitis, and this may be a little hard for you to see, but there are multiple small central lobular nodules here. Okay. BOOP is really an interstitial lung disease, and I cover that with the infiltrative lung disease. Okay, this is the final set here, and we're just going to talk about constrictive bronchiolitis. These are the etiologies, toxic fumes like chlorine gas, for example. You sometimes hear stories about that from swimming pools where patients have respiratory distress. Post-infectious is usually post-viral. Doesn't happen very often, but occasionally after a viral pneumonia, there may be obstructive bronchiolitis. Connective tissue disease, the classic example is rheumatoid disease. Certain drugs and organ transplantations. Now, the pattern's very different from proliferative bronchiolitis. You're not going to see the bronchi, right? You're going to see the secondary effects. And that's usually what's termed a mosaic pattern. There'll be patchy areas, decreased attenuation due to air trapping. There may be some mild central bronchiectasis. You need the expiration view to see the air trapping, and there'll be attenuation of peripheral vessels. And here is an example of post-viral. And this is the normal one, what looks like ground glass, and these. The black area here is the abnormal lung. There's a little central bronchiectasis here, and if you did expiration, you'd see air trapping. Swaya James is an example of that. This is a post-viral bronchiolitis obliterans. Again, this mosaic pattern, these black areas are abnormal lung, and they will air trap on an expiration view. Swaya James is typically unilateral on plain film, but as you can see in high-resolution CT, it's often bilateral. Patient with rheumatoid arthritis. This kind of black oligemic area here on the left upper wall, inspiration, expiration. Look at the dramatic difference. These areas of increased attenuation of the normal lung that has less air as on the expiration view, and these are areas of air trapping. And ground glass, this mosaic pattern can sometimes be seen within interstitial lung disease, and that's why it's so important to analyze the vessels and to get an exploration view. This is actually the cystis cranii pneumonia, and you can actually see areas that are mixed. Okay, I'm going to stop at that point. I will show you some examples here of organ transplantation, but I'm hopefully taking you through a review of both peripheral central areas and intracranial lung disease.